Should you use niacin to lower your blood lipids? Hi, I'm Dr. Chris Masterjohn of chrismasterjohnphd.com, and this is Chris Masterjohn Lite, where the name of the game is details, schmetails, just tell me what works. And today we're going to talk about the use of niacin to control blood lipids. Niacin is not the first line of defense for controlling blood lipids according to conventional medical guidelines. However, many people are using it for this purpose, and so it deserves some attention. Recent analyses of the available science suggest that niacin does, in fact, lower the risk of cardiovascular disease. In fact, for every 18 people who take it for that purpose, it looks like we're saving one person from heart disease. That is a pretty good result at first glance. However, it also looks to be the case that when we look at the same science, for every 43 people who take niacin for this purpose, one of them is getting diabetes. It basically works out that for every 7 people that we save from heart disease with high-dose niacin, 3 of them are going to get diabetes. And although that's doing more harm than good, we would hope to see safer ways of reducing the risk of heart disease. Because in fact, there are some things that we can do that reduce the risk of heart disease and reduce the risk of diabetes. Now, in future episodes, I will talk about for people who are going to use niacin or who are already using niacin, how do you do it safely and how do you do it without being one of those people who does develop diabetes? There is some science suggesting how we can use niacin more safely than it's being used currently. But here I want to talk about just the general cost-benefit analysis. So I think it's important to keep in mind two things. Number one, using niacin in this way is using it as a drug. Even though niacin is natural, and even though niacin is vitamin B3 and is found in food, when we consume niacin in food, it will not lower our blood lipids like this. We are using niacin at doses far higher than could be consumed in food because it has an effect when we do so to lower blood lipids that is not a normal nutritional role of the vitamin. Therefore, using it like this is a drug. So we should not think that there's anything specially natural about niacin when used in this way, or that there's anything more natural about niacin than about some other drug like statins to control cholesterol levels. Number two, niacin appears to have some benefits towards heart disease, but have some negative effects towards diabetes. So we should think about whether there are natural ways that will reduce the risk of heart disease and diabetes. So let's think about what niacin is doing to lower blood lipids. The way that it works is it suppresses your release of fatty acids from your fat tissue. Those fatty acids would have gone to your liver. They would have been converted into triglycerides that would have left your liver in what we call VLDL particles. And those VLDL particles would eventually have become LDL particles in your blood. But since the high-dose niacin stopped you from releasing your fatty acids from your fat tissue, then it stopped that process from happening and lowered the LDL in your blood. Well, why are free fatty acids elevated in people who have high blood lipids? The main things that elevate your fatty acids in your blood are number one, being overweight or obese, and number two, being insulin resistant, which is more complicated than simply being overweight, but one of the major drivers of insulin resistance is being overweight. So we could achieve what niacin is doing by optimizing our body weight to get into a healthy, lean body weight. By maximizing our insulin sensitivity, and that means achieving that lean body weight, exercising regularly, and eating a highly nutritious diet that doesn't have a lot of junk. And then once we are insulin sensitive, working healthy carbohydrates into our diet will further suppress those free fatty acids. If we take that approach, we are achieving what niacin would have done to lower blood lipids, but instead of increasing the risk of diabetes, we're actually squashing the risk of diabetes down while we squash the risk of heart disease down. There are additional natural ways involving diet and lifestyle that I believe are effective for controlling blood lipids beyond what I just described. And I, in fact, did a previous episode called The 5 Best Ways to Lower Cholesterol Naturally. And I'll link to that previous episode in the description of this one. But with all that said, diet and lifestyle does not always work for controlling blood lipids. And this is especially true for people who have familial hypercholesterolemia or a related condition where for genetic reasons, they have poor clearance of LDL particles from their blood. And I think particularly in these genetic cases, it does make sense to pursue a drug-related way to control blood lipids. Conventional medical guidelines put statins and several other treatments ahead of using niacin to control blood lipids. I do think that there's some bias involved because niacin is not patentable and is not going to make the degrees of profits that statins could. And I think that's part of the preference. I also think statins are overprescribed, and I think their potential side effects are underappreciated. So I do believe that in working with a doctor to make sure that your plan is properly individualized to you and that you do recognize that using niacin in this way is using niacin as a drug, I do believe that in some cases where because your genetics are so big of a factor, that if diet and lifestyle is not a way to get your blood lipids under control, that niacin should at least be a tool in the kit for you to potentially work with. And because of that, I'm going to do a couple episodes on how to safely use niacin in this context in the next couple of videos. This episode is brought to you by Vitamins and Minerals 101. This is my new free 30-day course providing one lesson a day on each nutrient delivered straight to your inbox. It can go to your email or it can go to your Facebook Messenger. If you get the Messenger version, it's taught by Chris Masterbot, my baby bot. It's more interactive, there are more emojis, and there are more jokes. But both email and Facebook Messenger are incredibly educational. Each lesson covers why the nutrient is important to your health, how to know if you have too little or too much or the wrong balance with other nutrients, how to get it from food, and when you should think about supplementing. It is not a technical or advanced course. It is completely minimum in its technical jargon, and it is designed for the beginner with no background in nutrition and no background beyond high school in the basic sciences. Nevertheless, many people who have backgrounds in nutrition are saying that it is an amazing refresher course full of nuggets of valuable information in each lesson. Sign up completely free by Facebook Messenger or by email at chrismasterjohnphd.com/101. This episode is brought to you by Testing Nutritional Status, the ultimate cheat sheet. This is my recipe to empower you to banish any deficiency or nutritional imbalance from your body. I've been through the pain of my teeth falling apart, my stomach being in constant pain, and my OCD going off the rails during my stint with veganism, to the point where panic attacks were the norm and I was afraid to eat any of the food in my house. I've been through the path of healing using nutrient-dense animal foods to nourish all the systems of my body and become a new person. But I've also learned that my needs change over time. The red meat and liver that were so healing in my recovery from veganism later started sapping my energy and brain power, only to find out that I'm genetically predisposed to iron overload and need to manage it with blood donations. And I've learned from friends, colleagues, and clients that everyone is different. Your needs are not mine. Mine aren't what they were 10 years ago. Yours won't be what they are now in 10 years. That's why we need a precise recipe to know exactly what's missing, exactly what's overloaded, exactly what's imbalanced, and an action plan to fix things, and a way to measure our success. That's what I've done with Testing Nutritional Status, the ultimate cheat sheet. Get your copy at chrismasterjohnphd.com/cheat sheet and use the code LITE20, that's LITE and the number 20, LITE20 to get 20% off. For ad-free versions of these episodes with transcripts that you can read and getting early access to the episodes often weeks or maybe even months ahead of time, you can sign up for the CMJ Masterpass at chrismasterjohnphd.com/masterpass and use the code LITE10 to get 10% lifetime discount. The audio of this episode was enhanced and post-processed by Bob Devodian of Torian Mixing. You can find more of his work at torianonlinemixing.com. All right, I hope you found this useful. Signing off, this is Chris Masterjohn of chrismasterjohnphd.com. This has been Chris Masterjohn Lite, and I will see you in the next episode.